Michael Jackson's Thriller Album.
Stories in the Room.
This is Michael Jackson's Thriller Album, Stories in the Room. Join film composer Anthony Marinelli, who programmed synthesizers for 7 songs on Thriller, and A&R veteran film producer Stephen Ray, who assisted Quincy Jones and was in the studio every day with Quincy and Michael.
Michael Jackson's Thriller Album, Stories in the Room.
I'm Anthony Marinelli with my longtime close friend and co-host, Stephen Ray, bringing you the real stories directly from the talented people in the room with us during the making of Thriller, the greatest selling album of all time.
Paul, we wanted to ask you, when did you meet Michael and when did you meet Quincy?
Interesting. I met Michael in 1979. They were working on the Destiny album that Greg Milligan's produced. It'll come back to me later. But Greg actually called me to play on the Destiny record. And so I met all the brothers at that point, and then I met Michael as well. So doing a lot of that record. Had a great time. That was fun. 1979 is when we met.
Where'd you do that? Was that Cherokee?
Yeah, we did it at Cherokee. Wow, you got a great memory. Oh my gosh. Yep, we did it at Cherokee, yep. Right there on Fairfax. Yep.
I mean, sure, that's just so many great, yep. That was the groove. That's where all that stuff came from, that I remember. It's easy to remember that because I grooved out the record, playing it over and over.
Yeah. Me too. I mean, even though I played on it, it's like, I met Quincy in 1981, I believe it was. He was working on James Ingram's solo album. And so he called me in to play on James's solo record. And after that, I started working with him, reasonably frequently. And I think the next project that I did with him was Thriller.
It was the other way. It was the other way around, actually. I remember. Thriller came first, and then we did James in 83. So did you play on Quincy's Dude album that James did just once in 100 ways?
I did not.
Because Thriller was 82. Oh, okay. So you came on James after Thriller, because I remember we went on vacation after Thriller and
came
back and did James.
You're right. Because Quincy made a comment, and I'll never forget, because before he did his solo record, because James had sung on Just Once and 100 Ways, and Quincy made the comment, James is going to be a star before he ever has a solo record. So you're absolutely right. Yep, you're right.
Not such a bad start. Yep,
I had to turn around.
So that being the first one, like, was that a different experience from anything else you had done? I mean, you worked with the Jacksons, but having Michael and Quincy kind of driving the show, how did it strike you as a different experience and the whole overall just vibe of being there?
Well, it was amazing, because the good thing about Quincy was he never really asked you, or I shouldn't say never, he didn't want to know just what you were going to play. He also wanted to know what you thought. Mm. And he calls you for the session based on your reputation, but also, he would find out, what are you thinking? What are you thinking? How can you make this go, let's try this, try something else, try whatever you want to try. Mm-hmm. And then he would kind of steer it. If it got off the rails, he'd put it back on the rails. If it was going too fast, he'd pull it back. If it was going too slow, he'd push it. But the cool thing was Quincy always wanted to know what you thought, not just what you were going to play. And that was all. I thought that was really, really cool.
Yeah, it's a higher concept. I mean, they clearly had the visual thing in mind. And every time we talk to someone, these are like indicative of some of artists that are trying to transcend just audio music or something, because it was such a visual album. And then it just broke ground, and it basically led the way in MTV beyond even what the MTV artists were doing. There's a little bit of a foray in there, but then Michael popped in. It was just like, these are films. And so Quincy asking that, I think it was just indicative of where they were going. They were just ahead of everybody. That's what it seems like to me.
Yeah, I would agree with that. And, pushing the envelope. And of course, that was Michael's personality, is always, pushing the envelope. How can it be better? How can it be more amazing? How can it be more innovative? And that's one of the things I really appreciated about working with Michael, just a consummate professional. It was always like, how can it be better? You know, what else can we do?
Right. And Quincy was casting the musicians according to a lot of things, I think, what they brought to the table as overall musicians, not you just as a guitar player, I think.
Right. I would agree with that. Yeah, I'd say that's true.
Yeah, because it's like contributing to the arrangement.
Right, right. And to that, you know, point, your involvement with P.Y.T. and Lady My Life and Beat It, I mean, what was your experience in terms of when you came in on P.Y.T., for example, of course, that James Ingram wrote, you know?
Yeah. Well, it was...
What was that like?
It was a lot of fun. What basically, I remember the tracking date was in the B. It was in B. I was going to say the smaller room at Westlake on Beverly. And James and Greg Fillinganes were there. Lewis Johnson was there. I was there. And Anthony was there. And I remember James was running the song down. And so we did a track of it. You know, just kind of cut a track of it.
Right.
And, you know, I didn't really think too much. And then Quincy called me back to come in and overdub. Well, when I came into overdub, it was just Quincy, Bruce, and myself. And Bruce was, you know, he had this thing, which I will not disclose, called the Acusonic music recording process. And I won't disclose it, but suffice it to say, I had enough room to just try anything I wanted. And so I think that day I put down about 7 tracks of guitar for PYT.
Mm. Right.
Yeah.
Right.
And he just let me create, just try stuff. Try this, try that. One thing I do remember is in the bridge where let's see. So I doubled the bass line with kind of like a power guitar sound. Mm-hmm. And then I left it out. And Quincy's like, oh, no. He said, once you bring it in, don't leave it out. So in the vamp, and only in the vamp, after the bridge, you hear the bass, you hear the synth bass, but you also hear the guitar playing. Let's see. So you hear the guitar, the rock guitar playing along with the bass, because he didn't want it to fall out there. But yeah, that was about 7 tracks of guitar.
But you know what? That's another thing. That's like way ahead of its time, because now Pro Tools, we have 200 tracks. Back then we had 24 tracks and then a click maybe, and then a buffer track so it wouldn't bleed. So really only 22 tracks and then 5 tracks for drums. And you're down to like, you know, in the teens, and he's given you 7 tracks back then. So that's thinking like, again, film mix, you know, it's
well,
way ahead of their time.
That was part of the secret of the Acusonic recording process. Ooh. But you're absolutely right.
Well, you had to pull it off, though. You can't, like, it's great to just say it, but then for somebody to put themselves in a time machine and go back there and lock up the machines and do everything that they were doing. And you know, Stephen, how many times did you have a story where Bruce was locking up, dealing with the machines not working, and then Michael would run off where? To an adventure, right?
Right. We go to the Beverly Center. We walk over to the Beverly Center where we jump in the car and go riding around, you know, to get out, because he would get restless and, you know, just want to get out because the machines would lock up and Matt and Bruce are in there trying to recalibrate everything, reset everything. And we'd be down for 2 hours and we just leave.
Yeah. The magic was in the hard work. That's the magic. All the hard work.
Yeah, I remember those days. I can't even remember what the synchronizing device was called, but you know, like you said, you had the buffer, you had the synth, then the buffer track. So you were down to 22, and you had to wait till the machines would chase each other, and it was an interesting time.
Yeah.
Now we just copy and paste it. You know, it's like, yeah. Well, I don't, but anyway. But yeah,
slightly more exciting.
Join us for the next episode of Michael Jackson's Thriller album, Stories in the Room, with your hosts, Anthony Marinelli and Stephen Ray. Watch our extended interviews on youtube.com/@storiesintheroom. Audio only interviews are available on all podcast networks. Follow us on Facebook, Instagram, and TikTok @storiesintheroom. For the latest news and links, visit the website storiesintheroom.com. This podcast is produced by Christian D. Bruun and David Wolf, recorded by Audivita Studios. Additional recording by Ben Racklis. Edited by Jay Spang and Sean Hettinger. Music by Anthony Marinelli and Stephen Ray.
Michael Jackson's Thriller Album.